In heaven, we thank you that you are a friend who sticks by us closer than any brother. Lord, we thank you that you've watched over us as we slumbered and slept. God, we thank you that you were always there when we needed you the most. Lord, we thank you now that you've given us good wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. You've counseled us to be obedient to your will, and in all things righteous, you taught us to say yes. God, now I lift up into your presence those who are hurting and those who are vulnerable, those who are suffering with sickness of mind, body, or spirit. God, I pray for the callous and the unconcerned. I pray for that mother, that father, that son, that daughter, who's standing at the crossroads of confusion. I need to hear a word or two from heaven. God, I pray right now for those who are experiencing bereavement in their families. They've had a loved one who's transitioned from time over into eternity. Oh, great and awesome God, we come to you because there is no other name on earth among men and women whereby we may be saved but the name of Jesus. And so God, right now, in the name of Jesus, with all of our cares and all of our concerns at your feet, Lord, if you don't fix it, we just don't know what we'll do. Hear our prayers, grant us your abiding peace, mend the broken, lift the fallen, cheer the sad. Do it all in the name of Jesus. Oh God, I pray that you'll bless this word as it goes forth, that someone will hear, and in hearing will receive, and receiving will believe, and in believing will become doers of your divine word. And oh God, if there's anything I have failed to ask, please do not fail to grant. In the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and Savior, we do honestly pray. Amen. My brothers and sisters, I greet you a wonderful, pleasant morning. I want to invite your attention to the book of Acts, chapter 9, which is a very familiar passage of scripture, a passage of scripture which talks about the conversion of Paul. So to the book of Acts, chapter 9, beginning with verse 6 down to verse 10, and verse 10 will be our celebration text from Acts, chapter 9. And while you're thinking of Acts chapter 9, I also want to refer you over to Acts 22. We're going to look at two passages of scripture. They both are dealing with the same subject. On the one hand, it takes place in 9. 22, Paul describes it. So first, Acts 9, and then Acts 22. Here now the reading from this word, Acts chapter 9, beginning with verse 1. And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest and desired of him letters to Damascus, to the synagogue, that if he found any of his this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. And he fell to the earth and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, Who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, Arise and go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do. And then over to Acts 22, Acts chapter 22, and beginning with verse 6. And verse 6 of Acts 22 picks up where Acts 9 leaves off. Beginning now at verse 6. And it came to pass, now Paul is speaking in the first person, and it came to pass that as I made my journey and was come nigh unto Damascus, about noon, suddenly there shone from heaven a great light round about me, and I fell unto the ground and heard a voice saying unto me, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And I answered, Who art thou, Lord? And he said unto me, I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom thou persecutest. And they that were with him saw indeed the light and were afraid, but they heard not the voice of him that spake to him. And then our celebration text from verse 10. And I said, What shall I do, Lord? And the Lord said unto me, Arise and go into Damascus, and there it shall be told thee of all the things which are appointed for thee to do. So in Acts chapter 9, the conversion of Paul takes place. And then in Acts chapter 22, he's testifying. He's telling the world what took place over in Acts chapter 9. I want to talk briefly from the message, The Road to Damascus. The Road to Damascus. And so here in chapter 22, the book of Acts, this powerful and prolific retelling of the conversion of Paul is taking place from someone who is speaking from a first-hand encounter with God, setting aside the doubts and disbeliefs of what those in the audience must have been feeling. He's telling them firsthand that there is power in the conversion experience of God. And my brothers and sisters, you will find some interesting things taking place here on this road to Damascus. Here in chapter 9, in chapter 22, we find the apostle Paul, who gets converted. He's first Saul, and he gets converted from being an opponent of the cross into being a follower of the Lamb. In a very supernatural, God-directed moment, he was transformed from a persecutor of the saints into a persuader of sanctification. From one who had devoted his time fighting the church to one who gave his entire soul in the service of the Lord. This conversion that's taking place here. He's converted from someone who had served as the king's representative to now being an ambassador of God. And all of this majestic and supernatural transformation is taking place on the road to Damascus. Damascus was, and still is to this very day, the capital of the country of Syria, a place we hear in the news every night facing a civil war. This city, Damascus, located in the country of Syria, was a beautiful city, an oasis that sat on the edge of the Syrian and Arabian desert. It's about 130 miles east of Jerusalem, and it is said to be one of the most beautiful cities in all of Western Asia. When I was in that part of the world some years ago, I had it as a personal goal to try and make my way to Syria because I wanted to get a glimpse of Damascus, but more importantly, to just be in the presence of the prolific power that was demonstrated on the road to Damascus. Damascus has played a significant role in both the Old and the New Testaments. Damascus was At one time, a leading commercial and transportation center, and the city's location along the river, situated at the crossroads of two major and international highways, the Via Maras and another highway simply known as the King's Highway. Because of where it was located, Damascus was important for commercial and industrial reasons, but also for spiritual and religious reasons. You will recall that in Damascus, we find wealth and power and privilege. We find exploitation and exclusivity right there in Damascus. And ever since its ancient origins in the Old Testament, Damascus has been a unique place whereby God has wrought supernatural wonders. You recall the first time that Damascus is mentioned in the Bible is in connection with Abraham's rescue of Lot after he was kidnapped by a group of Mesopotamian kings. As a matter of fact, one of Abraham's senior servants, Eleazar, was actually from this beautiful city known as Damascus. Damascus was significant, I tell you. You also recall that after King Solomon's death, Israel was divided into two kingdoms. And because it was divided, this led to Damascus increasing its power. So anybody seeking power would have been interested and going to Damascus. Israel and Judah, over a period of time, both made agreements. They both struck deals, peace treaties, as it were, with Damascus, because the kings of Damascus were seen as powerful and almost omnipotent. But eventually, all the power, the grandeur, and the glory of Damascus will come to an end. Before it comes to an end, Damascus is so prolific in its power that it's able to dominate both of the Hebrew kingdoms, the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. And so for the remainder of the Old Testament, both of these kingdoms, north and south, suffered under the hand of Damascus. You also recall Naaman, the Syrian commander who encountered Elisha. He lived in Damascus and thought so well of Damascus that when Elisha told Naaman that all he had to do was go and wash in the muddy waters of the Jordan, he would be cured of his disease known as leprosy, which was a debilitating disease and a disease associated with the possession of evil spirits. Naaman thought so much of Damascus that he simply said, "Can I go back to Syria? Can I go back to Damascus? Are not Abner and Pharpar the rivers of Damascus better than all of the rivers of Israel?" There is, my friends, a danger in arrogance and ignorance. But nonetheless, Damascus, with all of its beauty, natural resources, able and efficient government, wealth and talent, like most cities, over time, it gave way to wickedness and weakness. And it is here, in this old, ancient, and important city, that God uses as a place of reference to teach the importance of fallen humanity stretching out his arms to loving divinity. Saul is on his way to this place called Damascus. You recall Saul was born in the city of Tarsus. By today's standard, that would be located in Turkey. And he began studying the Mosaic Law as a young boy, age 5 years old. Saul was about 5 years old when he began studying the Mosaic Law. He spent at least 18 years in the best Jewish seminaries of that day, sitting at the feet of Gamaliel, the best and most intellectual instructor of the law of Judaism. Saul spoke Greek, Hebrew, Aramaic, and even Latin. Saul was one of the leading figures in the synagogue, but Saul was a Hellenistic Jew. And these Hellenistic Jews, these were Jews who had converted to Islam outside of Jerusalem. And so these Hellenistic Jews felt that they were the true keepers of the Mosaic law. And so Saul, having studied at the feet of Gamaliel and studied religiously the Mosaic law from the age of 5, felt that it was his responsibility to help God keep people righteous. And so Saul is kind of troubled because they had worked hard to clean up Jerusalem, to turn people's eyes back to Jewish custom. And now word is breaking out that there is emerging in a place called Damascus a number of other Hellenistic Jews who have the nerve and the audacity to talk about a man named Jesus. And so in the Mosaic law, they have been instructed that salvation resides in Yahweh, in God, and God alone. And now you have these people in the synagogue of Damascus going around saying things like, "The just shall live by faith," and "If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus," all of these things about Jesus. And this disturbed Saul. You will recall in verse 1 of chapter 9 and in verse 1 of chapter 22, in both instances, the text opens up by saying that Saul was breathing out murder. He was wroth with anger. He was breathing out, not breathing in. Breathing out is when your very existence is motivated by what is on the inside of you. And what was motivating him was hatred for the church. And what he hated will come to be what he also loved. And so it's on this road to Damascus that the supernatural power of God would be revealed. And so one day as he's sitting around the synagogue, over in Jerusalem, and Jerusalem is about 130 miles east, which means it would have took him about 6 days walking at least to make it there. And so he is so intent on trying to get into God's business. That's the first thing I want to tell you. We've got to be careful, my friends, because there is a danger in a zealous, energetic, and devoted, ignorant worship. There is a danger when we are zealous and energetic and devoted in the wrong direction. Yes, he was zealous. Yes, he was energetic. Yes, he was committed, but to the wrong cause. And so word gets out that not only are people hearing the word being preached about Jesus, but the word begins to sweep all over Southwest Asia, that many are being converted. And this upset Saul, so much so, you'll know that over in Acts 26, Saul testifies and says, "Yes, I persecuted the church. Yes, I was there when men and women were bound. I was even consenting to the death of many martyrs." The first martyr of the Christian church was Stephen, who himself was a Hellenistic Jew. But at some point, he began to believe that salvation is in Christ alone. And when Paul got word that even Stephen, when Saul gets word that even Stephen was preaching this Jesus, he was there as they stoned Stephen to death. And Stephen uttered out those memorable last words, "Into thy hands, Father, I commend my spirit." And Saul testifies that I was there. I was energetic and I wasn't just part, but when there was a vote to sentence Christians to death, I always voted kill them. So he gets word while he's sitting around the synagogue. He's greatly respected as an offender of Orthodox Judaism. He's sitting around the temple and he's hearing that many are being converted to the way. The way is reference to the way of Christ, the way of cross, which is a way of suffering. And he goes to the chief priests of the temple and says, You check my record. You know, not only am I a Hellenistic Jew, but I'm also a Jew of the strictest teachings of the Pharisees. And I have a very legalistic interpretation of the law. And if we don't put a stop to this Jesus thing, it's gonna spread. And before long, you're gonna have drunks and prostitutes and liars saying that if I but confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus, I'll be. We've got to put a stop to them. They are gaining strength. The Bible says that many were converted in Jerusalem, and many were being converted in Damascus. But the many being converted in Damascus were being converted in the name of Jesus. He goes to the chief priest and says, you know the record is clear. I can be trusted. Give me permission. Give me the letters that anybody, man or woman, I find on the way, that I will have your permission to bound them up. Listen, church, it wasn't enough that he was going to Damascus to get those who were already bound. There were people already in Damascus in chains, and he was going to get them, to bring them from Damascus back to Jerusalem, to convert them or kill them. But he wanted special permission that on my way, on the road to Damascus, if I encounter anybody who believes in this Jesus, I want permission to bind them up too. And my brothers and sisters, his destination was Damascus, but glory was his destiny. Destination and destiny are two different things. Our destination is where we're headed. Our destiny is what God has purposed for us. And while he's on the road to Damascus, a very miraculous thing takes place. The Bible says that a light shone down from heaven. And now this light could also be understood to be Jesus, whom John declared is the light of the world. And this light shines down from heaven. And a voice, the same voice that spoke in the burning bush and got Moses' attention, that same voice that descended like a dove when Jesus was in the River Jordan, saying, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased, that same voice speaks to him and says, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And you notice, my friends, something interesting takes place. There is, I tell you, something unique about the voice of Jesus. It is unmistakable, and it's also undeniable, because he says, Lord, who art thou? He recognizes the voice, and the voice says, I am he whom thou persecutest. The second thing I want to tell you, be careful that you recognize the voice of Jesus. So the road of Damascus is symbolic of leaving the familiar and going into the unknown. And God knows that many of us are on our own Damascus road, whether it's at work or in the family or in the community. Many of us are being challenged to leave what is familiar and go into the unknown. I just want you to remember, the unknown might be your destination, but God knows it's not your destiny. Your destiny transcends your destination. Your destination is just a holdover. It's a rest stop. It's a way station on the way to your destiny. And the voice says to him, I am he whom thou persecutest. That's the third thing that I want to tell you. When you know him, you ought to claim him. Saul was in love with God, but he did not yet know Jesus. He was in Jerusalem at the same time that Jesus was in Jerusalem, but he had no time to get to know him. He was too busy studying at the feet of Gamaliel. Had he taken a little time and gone across time, he could have met the man for himself if you know the Lord. You ought to own him on the road to Damascus, in the White House or the State House, in sickness or in health, in the good times or the bad times, in COVID or in cure. If you really know him, you ought to recognize him. And the voice is unique and it is particular. Everybody there also heard the same thing, but they did not recognize who it was. The Bible says Saul is stricken with blindness for 3 days. For 3 days, he's in the dark. For 3 days, he's in the unknown. For 3 days, in the unfamiliar. For 3 days, in troubled waters. In 3 days, depending on somebody else. For 3 days, needing help. For 3 days, he needs assistance. But God told him, there's a man down in the city, and he's gonna tell you what you ought to do. God always has a way of escape. For 3 days without food, for 3 days without water, for 3 days without comfort, for 3 days without assistance, but just in time, God speaks to Ananias and tells him, Ananias, I know a man who's been on the road to Damascus. You know the road of Damascus is a dangerous road. It is a winding road. It is a long road. It is a treacherous road. There are all kinds of jaywalkers and hipsters and tricksters on that road. And he's been on that road. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to go and lay your hands on him. That's the next thing I want to tell you. If you're on the road of your Damascus, trying to make sense of what God is trying to tell you, trying to figure out what God has in store, trying to understand where God is leading you, don't give up. Don't throw in the towel. Don't walk away. In God's own time, he'll give you what Saul received. The Bible says Ananias laid his hands on Saul. That's what we need, a touch from the Lord. If you're sick, a touch from the Lord. Confused, a touch from the Lord. Looking for a way out, a touch from the Lord. And after Ananias lays his hands on Saul, the Bible says the scales fell off his eyes. There are two things about being on a road to Damascus. The first thing is blindness will cloud your vision. He could not see. He had to be led. Somebody else had to take him in. Somebody else had to bring him out. He was blind because on the road to his own Damascus, the light shone from heaven and clouded his eyes. Sometimes God has to cloud eyes so that we can see when the scales fall off. But not only is the road to Damascus a road that will blind your vision, but the second thing is the road to Damascus proves that there is no hell so low, no pain so deep, no burden so heavy, no sin so great that God cannot save you on the road to Damascus. Is there anybody here in love with the things of God, but confused by the way of God? Is there anybody here trying to follow the blessings of God, but not follow the teachings of God? On your road to Damascus, I want you to understand that God, yeah, God has you on the road for a reason. I thank God for every burden. I thank God for every tear. I thank God for every pain. It's just evidence that God has something greater on the other side of Damascus. Hold on, walk the road, stand in faith, don't give up, don't throw in the towel. It's not over. You're just on the road to your greatness, to your destiny. You're on the road to your ministry, to your breakthrough. The Bible says that Saul became Paul. If he had not gone on the road to Damascus, we would not have 13 books in the New Testament. If he had not gone on the road to Damascus, we would not know that when I'm weak, I am strong. If he had not gone on the road to Damascus, we would not know to live is Christ and to die is gain. If he had not gone on the road to Damascus, we would not know that the wages of sin is still death. But glory, whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. God bless you on the road. God bless you on the way. God bless you through the tears. God bless you through the blindness. God bless you through misunderstandings. Stay on the road, and when it's all over, you'll understand why it had to be this way, why you had to travel that road, why you had to go through that pain, why you had to say goodbye, why you had to wave farewell. God bless you. Stay on the road to Damascus. On the other side, yes, there's fellowship on the road. Somebody has been on the road. You were headed in one direction, didn't know why, thought you were going for one thing. God has something else in store. We've often asked, why did it have to be this way? Why do we have to experience it? God knows. He has us where we are for a certain reason and for a certain season. I've often asked myself, Lord, does it have to be this way? But yes, yes, my life is but a weaving between the Lord and me. I may not choose the colors. He knows what they should be, for I can view the pattern from this, the underside, while he can view the pattern from the upper side. Sometimes he weaveth sorrow, which seems strange to me, but I will trust his judgment and work on faithfully, not till the loom is silent and shuttles cease to fly, shall God unveil the canvas and explain the reason why the dark threads are as needed in the master's skillful hand as the threads of gold and silver in the pattern he has planned. He started one way. God redirected his path. Many of us have started one way. God can redirect us. He'll take us. He'll keep us. He'll bring us. And in the end, he'll come and receive us. There's fellowship on the road. There's suffering on the road. There's peace on the other side. What a fellowship. What a joy divine. I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness. What peace is mine. Oh, I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. I'm leaning. Yes, I am. Yes, I am. I'm leaning. Oh, I'm so safe and secure from all alarm. I'm leaning. Yes, I am. Yes, I am. Oh, I'm leaning. I'm leaning. And I won't let go. His arms. Father in heaven, I pray now for that person who's on the road. They started out, oh God, from the time they started, so many have left. We look around and so many familiar faces, they've left us here. Many who started out with us have turned around. But God, I know that somebody is still on the road. They love you. They believe in you. You're all they have. Oh God, I pray for the conversion spirit that met Saul and changed his name. To meet someone who hears my voice, change their name, but not only their name, change their reputation. It happened on the road to Damascus. It can happen on the road to Anniston and the road to Birmingham. It can happen wherever hurting people are. Give somebody a conversion spirit, a conversion experience, a converted attitude in the name of Jesus. Forget the past. Overlook our many faults and deeds. Clean us up. Confirm our faith. Strengthen our hope in the name of Jesus. In thee have we trusted. Let us nevermore be confounded. We love you today because you first loved us. Thank you, God, for meeting us on the roads of life, wherever we are. Lead us to and through the other side. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.